Welcome to Scotch and Soda.
Thank you.
Although this is not a Scotch, we're drinking Bren whiskey. It's from France.
Thank you.
This is just for you. I thought this would match your personality because it's sweet, you know.
And yet.
Yes.
It's sweet, but.
Also alcoholic. this is the perfect choice I had for you. This is pre-selected for you just from BevMo San Diego. So welcome. This is like the pilot episode of you're my first guest here, and I'm honored and glad to have you here.
Thank you.
How do you feel to be here?
I'm very happy. Yeah. We have so much stories, you and I, to tell, and our passion together.
Yes, with movies, which is cinema.
Yes.
Remember like the first time we met?
Yes, I remember.
Would you mind sharing?
So I was in this meeting at the company we're working for, and it was like this happy hour Friday, and we had a bunch of 20 people, and we had V from India, Guillaume from France, and pretty much everybody was from America, and they asked the questions like, what's your favorite movie? And everybody was like, Fast and Furious Episode 3, Mean Girls, etc. And I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
And I go like, hey, I'm not sure. It's between Blade Runner and Manchurian Candidate from John Frankenheimer. And then we have V, who says...
Big Lebowski.
The Big Lebowski. And I was like, oh my gosh, that guy just knows about American movie, but probably more than anyone in the room.
So you didn't expect that from a non-American to say Big Lebowski?
It's not that you expected, but It was like an agreeable surprise. I was like, I love cinema. It is something that connects with people, etc. And there's people who are not into cinema, which is fine. It doesn't mean I connect to people.
Right.
But it is something that connects to people. And I was like, oh my gosh, this guy saying the Big Lebowski. I was like, okay, I need to talk to these guys. And since then, we're, you know, best friends.
So that was like a turn on from you. When like someone knows about cinema, it's like you're instantly like inclined to talk to them. Just because you're passionate about cinema too.
But also the interesting thing is I was at a deeper level. I was like, I know the Coen Brothers movies. And I was like, why do you say The Big Lebowski? Because if I had to choose from all the Coen Brothers movies,
yeah,
it would probably not be The Big Lebowski. It would be Blood Simple.
Yes, I think that's the first movie, right?
One of the first movies. And it was like, why The Big Lebowski? It's an amazing movie, but I was curious what impact it has to. So it was not so much about like, oh my gosh, he loves the Coen Brothers movies. It was like, okay, I need to talk to this guy. Not so much about he chose The Big Lebowski, but like out of all the Big Lebowski movie, Miller's Crossing, which is amazing. It took me a lot to watch because I had to have subtitles.
Why? They're Irish? Yeah, they're Irish
speaking.
Yes,
it's like Irish Mafia. It's so difficult to read. But I was like, out of all the big of the Coen Brothers, why this movie? Why is this movie? Which was the interesting part of it.
Go. So we were talking about Big Lebowski. So we connected on Big Lebowski, on cinema and the passion for cinema. To understand cinema, and because you yourself, your story is you came from Paris when you were really young. Go ahead, you know, and you produced or directed a short film or assisted in directing a short film when you were young. And
I was raised in Paris, loved cinema, wanted to be a director. My dad didn't want me to be a director. Mm-hmm. He's like, you're gonna be in a business school. It's like, okay,
yeah.
And but I had a passion for American cinema, raised in it. It was like, you know, it was everything to me. And French people were very good at making romantic comedies,
mm-hmm.
but they were always complaining, like, oh, the screens in France are, you know, being overloaded with, you know, action movies from America. I'm like, well, it's okay. So make action movies.
Yeah.
Make action movies. Don't complain about it. Do something.
Right.
So yeah. I did. I was a big fan of John Woo at the time.
Oh, John Woo, actually.
John Woo.
Yeah, yeah.
And we were friends. We made this action movie out of nowhere on a weekend in August. There was no one in Paris. I was like, we're bored. And I was like, let's make a movie. So I called my friends, make a movie. We won in a festival, best editing. I was an editor at the time, and it was a realization at that time of, you know, I was fed up. I was like, this is not the right environment for me, and I moved to the US.
So you were really into action movies, not like the amour of the like the French, like the Paris, like they were into like love and
I all do, that. But I was raising so much of that, yeah. Which is amazing. But I was like, I wanted something different. And I like, you know, I like action, I like roughness, etc. I was raised in this like super bourgeois neighborhood in France, in Paris. There was nothing exciting on the weekend. It's like, you know, like the worst crime for the past 20 years, it was probably a grandma who got her bag stolen by someone on a motorcycle. That was it. And I come to LA.
Yes.
And, you know, back in 1995, and I was like, I wanted something like, I don't know, more raw, more like danger. I was excited.
Different types of crime.
I was excited.
No, that's interesting. So when you say American movies, you used the words action, and the other word you used was action and much more, something other than love, right? And you, when you define American cinema, is that your definition of American cinema?
No, not. I mean, it's a very good question. I don't have the total answer. Like, I can watch some, you know, classic American movies that are not all, you know, all about action.
Yeah.
But the way it's produced, the way it's directed, there's an element to it that is very visually sound. Attractive that it's put in a way that is, you know, just like makes you dream. And probably a part of it is, you know, is like I was dreaming, I was in France, etc., and I was like dreaming by something else. It was a gateway for me. It was something different.
It was
more adventure. Yes, adventure. I love adventure.
Okay.
I love adventure. Absolutely. And it was a gateway for me because in France we have all these romantic comedies, we're very good at it, and I was like, I want something, you know, it's like, you know, American, very good Westerns, whatever. It's like, I wanted something that was like much more adventurous, that was inspiring for me, more than French movies that were so narrow in what they were doing. It's a good question. I don't have the answer to it.
It's not just one. It's much more complicated than that. It's not just one aspect of American cinema. It's just a cocktail of like different elements. It's the direction, it's the budget.
But you make me think about it right now. It's like you ask me a question that I've never asked myself, probably. And it's just my love for, you know, action, outdoor, you know, big planes. You know, and American cinema has that, you know. And in France, we don't have that. Right. And actually it changed until Luc Besson starting to do invest in production companies and starting to do like movies in France, like sci-fi movies, horror movies, action movies. But I left by that time. That's when
I
left.
Right. No, I don't. I mean, and still, like contemporary, is there like a good French cinema?
Like, what do you mean? Is a good French cinema?
Like, you know, if there's Hollywood in America, right? Like, is there like a community for cinema? I mean, no, there's like Cannes Film Festival, right? And in France, but. Contemporary, like I haven't seen, like, I mean, maybe it's my ignorance, but I haven't seen a French cinema being streamlined in the pop culture globally. So I'm asking, is it still prevalent, the French cinema?
So the thing I appreciate about American cinema, I mean, sorry, French cinema, is that. The one thing I really appreciate is like we have actors who've been making movies since they're like Jean-Paul Belmondo, who just passed away.
Mm-hmm.
Jean-Paul Belmondo was everything to me. He was an amazing actor. And he's been making movies since like 20 years old to 90 years old.
Right.
And that's very rare when you have an actor who's like, oh, just, you know, just like spans like multi-generation and still relevant to the different generation.
Right.
He make movies in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, etc. And still there, and still relevant. So French cinema, there's a context of like, I would say it's like, it goes through cultures.
Okay.
And in American cinema, you might have the same thing. There's some actors that are like, I don't know. I'm trying to find an actor that's been, you know, well, he's not American, but I love his guy. What's his name? Forgot his name.
Jean Desjardins?
No, he was in Batman. He was the butler.
Alfred, Michael Caine?
Yeah, Michael Caine.
He's not French.
No, he's British.
Okay.
He's British. But Michael Caine, from his first movies to today, it's like, it's Michael Caine. No matter what you see, it's like, oh my gosh, it's Michael Caine. He can be anything he wants to be from his early 30s to his early 80s or 90s.
It's like a Morgan Freeman of Britain.
Morgan Freeman started later in his career, where Michael
Caine... But still, Morgan Freeman in every role is like Morgan Freeman.
Yes, but Michael Caine started very early in his career.
Oh, okay, interesting. Super early. Interesting, yeah. Now, that's cool. So there's a passion, again, you know, we connected on the passion, you know, with for cinema, and you came to America, and let me ask you this, what's a movie that made you like, it could be recent, or it could be something you saw in your childhood, what's that movie you saw, and you were like, wow, this is just something I've never seen before. It's just, because cinema as an art form could impact you in various different phases, in different point of your life. So what's that one cinema, or it could be multiple cinema. What is that?
It's like where you were asking the question, I was like, oh my gosh, how am I going to answer that question? Because there's so many that comes in my mind and trying to pick, like, is it this one or this one or this one? But it's funny, it's in the Manchurian Candidate. John Frankenheimer, which
great movie.
John Frankenheimer is amazing director.
Great fucking movie, yeah.
And I love, you know, like politics, spy movies, etc. Some level of sci-fi to it. Black and white.
Yes. And I mean, the original one is black and white.
The original one. So John Frankenheimer with
Frank Sinatra.
Frank Sinatra was there. There's like a bunch of actors that was, you know, like famous actors, etc. And it the story, the subject is just so good. It is so amazing. And the way he directed the movie, I'm still blown away
absolutely.
Today. And there's a scene that I wish would be taught to any movie film school in the world. There's a scene where part of the story, there's these soldiers that are being brainwashed. They're being brainwashed and they believe. And there's a scene when you have like all these like conspirators, political conspirators around the world, and they're showing how they're brainwashing soldiers to do whatever they want with them.
Right.
And that scene is just showing them how they're being brainwashed, and they're gonna convince one soldier to kill the other one. And the soldiers believe they're having a tea party with old women. And it's like who came with this idea? And that scene is amazing.
No.
It's like, who came with this idea?
Is that the scene where the camera rotates in a room?
Yes.
God, great fucking scene. It's an amazing scene.
I know this magnificent hydrangeas on the hills, where the air drainage was perfect, and very poor specimens, or perhaps none at all, in the valleys. Formerly, we used to consider sheltered valleys more favorable to plants than hilltops. But the avoidance of late spring and early autumn frost enjoyed by sites with good air drainage, where the cold air can drain safely away to lower levels, gives the hills a decided advantage. Thus it was the hydrangeas that gave the first pointer in another modern discovery of horticultural importance. From this, it might appear that the hydrangea is a fairly simple plant, but there are more complications. The cultivation of hydrangeas was evolved from a number of varieties originally found in Japan, not all of which, of course, have the same characteristics. Two of them do not share the quality of producing blue flowers in mineral-rich soils.
Oh, great fucking scene. It's an amazing scene.
It's an amazing scene. And it's like, who has the balls? Put yourself back in 1960s, whenever the movie, that's it, to come up with an idea like, oh, we're going to do a scene with like American soldiers who are being manipulated by this like conspiracy group of high-level politicians and militaries around the world. And, you know, we're going to show them thinking they're having tea party with
right,
old women.
Right,
like,
right.
Who comes up with that? And when you watch the scene,
yeah,
you don't need special effects, you don't need green screen. It is amazing.
No, it's a great fucking movie. Even the ending of that movie is like, wow. Like the killer, like who's assassinating.
Yeah, who's the killer, yeah.
It was a great movie. And it was remade by Jonathan Demme with Denzel Washington.
And respect for Jonathan Demme, because when I saw that movie, I was like, who can remake that movie? And Jonathan Demme took a different angle, and the choice of actor was amazing. And it was a good movie. It was. I mean, you know, just the actors in it.
Absolutely. Sometimes when they remake movies, you're kind of like, ugh. Like, for example, like Blade Runner, Denis Villeneuve remade Blade Runner. And Blade Runner, Ridley Scott is one of my favorite fucking directors. And it's a very sophisticated movie. The mood he creates, it's very hard to replicate. But then he pulled it off. You know,
he did a good job because he was not really a remake. It was an extension of the story.
He expanded the
story. But he did a lot of the filming with in an analog world. There's not a lot of CGI too much to it. So
right,
you can feel
right.
it. You can feel that. And he extended the story from Philip K. Dick, which is one of my favorite sci-fi writer. And he extended that story with the same level of humanity of robots, you know, like am I human? Is my memory a dream? So he did a very good job, and kudos to do that. And you know, it's like you have to have a lot of guts to be able to take such a like classic movie and try to be, you know, your own style, your own signature, and put it off.
It's a lot of pressure. Blade Runner is a fucking historical sci-fi movie, and it's a lot of pressure. And I watched this movie at TCL in Hollywood, and I did not know, I haven't seen the previous Blade Runner, and while watching that movie, there's a scene in this movie, it's called Seawall, where it's an action scene where Ryan Gosling's character, he is fighting with this woman, she's a villain, and then there's Harrison Ford, where he's trying to rescue Harrison Ford, and they're drowning,
yeah.
and the sound in that theater,
yeah.
it's like,
yeah.
It's just unbelievable, and that's what's...
Off-world is waiting.
Unbelievable, and that's what's it's cinematically, it just draws you, and you're there, and it's like, you know, it's just wow, just you're it's very gripping. So Ridley Scott, speaking of going back to Ridley Scott, it's also one of your favorite directors.
Yes, and actually Prometheus,
yes, Aliens,
that is one of my favorite movies. So see, when you said like what's your favorite movie, I'm like, oh my gosh.
No, it could be multiple.
For what reason, what's your
what's
your favorite movie that inspires you, like for different like sensations of things that inspires you. Prometheus for me is inspiration in terms of like filmmaking. I watched this movie 20 times.
Right.
And the first time I watched it, I didn't like it.
Okay.
I didn't like it. And I was like, why I don't like a movie from Ridley Scott? And I'm like, no, there's something wrong. I'm going to make an effort. And I watched it a second time, and a third time, and a fourth time, etc. Every shot in these movies are amazing. You can deconstruct whatever the actors and even the story is that this in between alien, there's not so much alien thing because he did an amazing job, because like we've seen Alien, the monster, etc. That movie is more about, it's not so much about the alien, it's like the story, the why, and it every shot in this scene are amazing, every the sound, the texture, everything. Watch this movie, it's just mind-blowing in terms of acting. Like if you ask me, like If I achieve something as a director, like if this is what I'd love to achieve.
No, and I think Ridley Scott is kind of like, he mastered that craft like years back with Aliens, the first one. And then I think Ridley Scott was followed by James Cameron and David Fincher. I think James Cameron made Aliens 2, And David Fincher made another, I think, another spin-off of Aliens, I think.
The third one, and there's Genet, Jean Genet, the French director, who did the third or fourth one, I forgot exactly.
Yes. I think David Fincher also kind of made
yes.
a movie based on
yes.
James Cameron's movie. Ridley Scott's movie. But they turned out to be great fucking directors too, David Fincher and James Cameron. And we both watched, you suggested this documentary to me, actually, on Netflix.
The Movies That Make Us.
Oh, great documentary.
And how James Cameron pulled out the movie. And it's funny, it's interesting because, and that's one thing, like, startup, like, you know, I work in technology in startup. But the analogy with making movies is the exact same way. Like, you want, you know, you have investors who are spending $5 million, $10 million, $20 million.
Right.
And hoping that this is going to be the big hit.
No.
They're going to make 100 millions.
It's a gamble.
Etc. And Aliens 2, it was such a mess in the back scene when you watch the documentary.
Yeah.
Like the crew, and you know what? This is a call and respect to Sigourney Weaver, because the entire crew was about to move out because James Cameron was being an asshole.
Sigourney
Visionary.
Weaver is the lead actress.
She's the lead actress.
Okay.
And James Cameron had this amazing vision, right? But he was being an asshole.
Yeah, he was chaotic. He had this madness towards this, and
yes.
he was like being an asshole. Yeah, you're right.
Yes,
yeah.
And an amazing asshole.
Yeah.
Because the movie is amazing.
Amazing asshole, yeah.
But the entire team was about to move out, and the production company went to Sigourney Weaver, which is an amazing person, even a personality, who said, you know, can you save this production? Can you save this movie?
Yeah, no.
And she came back to James Cameron when you watch the documentary, and she's like, dude, you know, just apologize to the team.
Yeah, no.
Just, you know, and he came back and the team was like, oh, cool. And they finished the movie.
James Cameron is kind of crazy. James Cameron does, you know what? James Cameron actually, apart from directing movies or producing movies, he actually is an adventurer. Like he actually goes,
diving. Yes.
Diving, like deep fucking diving. Like imagine like you have enough money as James Cameron. You just wake up and you decide to like, it's not like regular diving. You just like,
yeah.
It's like the deepest
deep sea
in the ocean
yeah.
you've ever been
yeah.
in a submarine or something. So he's on another level. Like he's just crazy as fuck. But,
and this is, so going back to your original question.
Yeah.
When I was in France, I had this taste for adventure.
Yeah.
Danger,
yeah.
doing this crazy thing. And French cinema was all about romantic comedies. Well, they're very good about it. They're super good about
yeah.
it. But I was like, I want to see adventure. I want to see these crazy stories.
Yeah.
And that's what attracted me to the US, which was the reason I left. It's like, it was not satisfying for me. It was like, I was so comfortable. Nothing was happening. I was like very comfortable. And I was like, I want to be out of my place. I want to be in a different, you know, like I want to be challenged. I want to be in danger. And that's what attracted me.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And too much romance can be monotonous. And you need like, you know, as a creative, I think you need to be more adventurous. You need to be willing to do the things that other people don't do. That's the conflict that creative has, because, you know, you're pushing the envelope. And that's what made people successful, like with James Cameron, all the directors we talked about, and all the people who work in movies we talked about, they're pushing, because this has never been done before, and they did it and they pulled it off, and it's successful. Because watching Prometheus, Alien, or Blade Runner, you've never seen this on the screen before. It's like something you've never experienced before, and that's what cinema does to you.
But this is American cinema, where American cinema is not afraid to push the boundaries.
Yeah.
To try something, to try, to do the investment in it.
Yeah, they're ballsy. No, they absolutely just do it. And sometimes they fail. And
failure is okay. And in America, failing is okay.
Yeah, that's majority of Netflix movies.
Yes, it is.
But failing is okay. But then, you know, you try, and if you have the obsession for the art form of movies, or obsession with anything, if you're really into it, you're obsessed with it, and if you're really living for it, I think you know, you it's and success doesn't matter because this is what you actually want to do. And so, oh, before that, we might have to introduce Bren. I'm going to pour you a glass of Bren.
I never tried this.
You don't try this?
Never tried this, yeah.
Okay, so I'm
it's French, it must be good.
I don't know. I don't know if French are allowed to make whiskey, but I'm pouring this. Oh my god, that's
would you say it's French? What?
I don't think they're allowed to make whiskey. Are they allowed to make whiskey? But let me put some ice onto this for you, and is that good?
That's good.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Wait for me. Wait for me so that we can cheers on this beautiful...
This is an interesting smell.
Wait, let's... What does it smell like? It smells like... It smells like bubblegum. It smells like bubblegum, like candy.
Cheers. I'm not sure. Oh, this is good.
It's kind of sweet.
Not too sweet, but this is good.
I mean, not aggressively sweet, but
no. But you know what? I've drank like cheaper.
Yeah, you just did before.
Yes, I did.
Yes.
So I've drank cheaper whiskey, and this is smooth. This is not. You know, it's like a good tequila versus a bad tequila. A bad tequila, you're like, oof. It's just like
yeah.
A good tequila, it's just like smooth. This is super smooth.
So yeah. You were saying that the whiskey is too smooth. It's kind of it's smooth and it's...
No, it's very smooth.
It's very smooth.
It's very nice. Like, I'm not a big whiskey fan.
Yeah.
But this is smooth. It's very smooth.
So this was interestingly... It was actually founded by women. It was a woman.
So in France?
No, she was not in France. She was American. And...
But you said it was French.
It was... So this is like made in French barrels and cognac casks. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah. So, so she actually founded it, and I tasted this like 5 years back, but then I didn't like it because it's not my taste. I mean, it's not great for like if you're like into whiskey, like if you're a whiskey fanatic, I don't think this is the best whiskey. But it's great for like starters. I think it's good for it's a dessert whiskey.
Someone
it's
like sweet. Me.
I mean, you're not into whiskey. I think you're more into like wine. You're red wine, right?
Yeah, more into wine. But no, this is very smooth. That I can drink. That I can drink. It's very smooth.
Yeah, no. No, I'm glad. I'm glad, you know, more women are getting into the business of whiskey. You know, power to women. Where are the cameras? Power to women.
Great. We're going to have to...
But, yeah, no, we were talking about cinema. How cinema... affected our lives, and all those questions I asked because, like, you know, I cannot pinpoint in my life like where I started to develop this affection towards cinema, because I just needed an exit in my life because reality was too boring, and you know, something I see on TV, something, and I see on theater, something, and I wanted to become that, or I would reenact the actors in the movie, or, you know, I want to become, because I thought there was a storyline in my movie, and I tried to reenact, and I thought most of my life I thought, you know, this is real, like this happens in reality, but then I forgot to draw the distinction. But
it's interesting you say that, because it's like, even if we come from different stories, different background, for me it was like exactly how you say, like, I'm not happy in my story here. Like when I was in France, like
I wanted
these different stories.
Right.
And it's interesting you say that, because at the core of it, and you make me realize it when you were asking me the question, because then you have the answer right away. I was like, oh my gosh, this is such a deep question. Is I love adventure.
Yeah.
I love to experiment. I love to try things. But France, unfortunately, is not a culture for that. Let's try. Let's not ask questions. Let's go do it.
Yeah.
We'll see if it fails. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
French is always yes, but.
Right.
It's always a yes, but. Well, but if we do this, we have to do that, etc. And which is what I love in America, which is why I moved to America, is because it gave me the opportunity to say, no, I want to try. Let's see. I'm not afraid to fail. And American cinema is the same way. Some directors would do these amazing movies. Like, we talked about it. William Friedkin. He did The Sorcerer.
Yeah, I'll talk about The Sorcerer.
When he did The Sorcerer, so when William Friedkin directing The Sorcerer, which is a remake from a French movie, actually.
Oh, shit, really?
Yes. In French, it's called Le Salaire de la Peur. So you have this ex-convict, and they need money, and they find this opportunity to drive this truck, which has, like, nitrogen,
scene.
You know, like this, like, great super dangerous, they might die, etc. So it's a remake from a French movie. Anyhow. But the direction, when they made the movie,
it's gritty, it's raw.
I mean, some of the actors might have died in the movie, etc. And it was it's totally crazy. And that is what I love about America. It's like, you have an idea, let's go do it.
Absolutely.
We're not going to question, etc. And this is the problem I have with the French culture. It's like, it's always like, it's the yes, but.
Yes, but okay.
Well, but if you do this, what's going to happen? Which has some benefit to it, because they always ask questions, etc. But there's a moment you're going to have to take action. You're going to have to do things, and I'm into action. I was like, well, let's go do it. Let's try. Let's see if it works.
No,
it's okay.
Absolutely, and Sorcerer is a great example of it. And that movie is like gritty, raw. Steve McQueen was signed on to it, and then William Friedkin was like, "Oh, we're going to go to like South Central America and film this with like this gritty." Raw setting, and Steve McQueen was like, I can't do this shit. And I think he signed Roy Scheider,
and yeah, I think he was almost sick with typhus or something. Yeah, like, it was horrible. And actually, they had a very hard time filming because he's the one who directed The Exorcist.
Yes.
And they went to film this movie in a very, like, you know, Catholic.
Yeah.
Right. And they were like, oh, this is a guy who directed The Exorcist. So he had a hard time. It was horrible. It was horrible. It was like, it was an absolute nightmare.
No, but it was a great fucking movie. Like, especially the last scene where they assemble the truck and the Tangerine Dream starts playing and the sequence where, I mean, it's kind of, I mean, when you look at it right now, it's kind of like, it's kind of cheesy. But then at the same time, it's epic. Like, when the tire goes off the rails at the hill, and then, again, the Tangerine Dream is playing in the background. It just, it's thrilling.
This is the thing, is like when a production company is struggling,
yeah,
or like, not production, but like when in a movie the entire team making the movie on a tight budget, they're struggling, that's when they're creative.
Yeah,
they're trying to make it happen, and you can feel that. Even if you and I are passionate about movies, and you show that movie with someone who's not passionate, they'll feel it. It's like, oh my gosh, that scene is amazing. You can sense it.
Yeah.
Subconsciously, you can sense it. But when you're very comfortable and there's CGI and there's everything, it's just like, it's canned food. It's like 2 weeks later, you forgot what you watched. You completely forgot to watch.
Yeah, I know.
And this movie was like legendary because, you know, it was it was in a condition that was like, you don't know what's going to happen. The actor might die in the movie. It is a completely different
setting. You can't make that kind of movie right now in
2022. But you can see the passion in the movie.
Yeah, exactly. That's art. You're willing to devote your life to this. Like, you don't care. And right now, you're too, like, I don't want to do this. You know, I have a trade union. I might, like, defend, you know, some people backing this up. And I want to be comfortable, you know. Let's make an action movie where... if you know, scenes where I'm not too comfortable with, let's put CGI into this. You know, it's easy. You know, but
and it's a challenge because for an actor to be able to go to that level, so there's directors that are very difficult. Like Michael Mann is a very difficult director to work with, and as an actor and an actress, like, or even even sorry, Shining.
Stanley Kubrick.
So even Stanley Kubrick is known to be extremely hard.
Oh yeah, he's an actor. Yeah, no, he
extremely hard. But as an actor and actress, like, you know, like, would I be willing to get in that situation? In working an actor is going to push me to a limit. Like, it's my decision. But it's amazing to have that opportunity to do that.
Yeah, because you're, if you're really into this, like, if you're really into quote unquote the profession of acting, I don't think it's a profession, but then you're doing this for because you're interested in this. You want to be used by directors like Stanley Kubrick and Michael Mann. I mean, that's you're refining your craft. You know, you're bettering as yourself as an actor. Like, I would, I mean, not, you know, that, not that I will, but I want to work with someone who's going to, like, you know, refine who I am. I don't want to be comfortable. And, I mean, speaking of Michael Mann, I'm not talking about the movie Heat. Great fucking movie.
I love that movie. It's amazing.
It's a fucking great movie.
It's an amazing movie. It's so intense.
The bank robbery scene. Oh, the final.
Yes, it's amazing. Which happened in LA, actually. That's a remake of something that happened in LA. There was a bank robbery and the they were all covered.
Yeah.
Etc. But just going back to what you said, this is why, like, Hong Kong action movies. And, you know,
John Woo,
the Hong Kong action movies in general, they do these stunts and they might die during the movie.
Yeah.
Jackie Chan, for example, Jackie Chan, so many times almost died in the movie. Like, he was in so many accidents. But it's like, it's amazing to see these people who are taking it almost like, you know, like challenging their life, taking risks to do these amazing movies. And it's a great respect. I love that. It's amazing. And which is why when you see, like, action movies from Hong Kong, some of the scenes are like, oh my gosh, it's like, it's crazy. It's like, it goes to another level.
Absolutely.
But it is not, I would say, not politically correct during these days. Like, actors have insurance. They cannot do this. Right, they cannot do that.
Yeah,
they have their Twitter account. They have to do this. And they're signed up with this brand, etc.
They're socially responsible.
I'm very old school. And, you know, and, you
pray
know,
for Ukraine. All right, go ahead.
What?
Pray for Ukraine. But sorry, go ahead.
But it's amazing to go to a movie and to see an actor or whatever, a stuntman who made this, like, amazing stunt.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
He could have died in it, etc. Yeah. It's like,
you have to watch, like, if you see a Jackie Chan movie, American Jackie Chan movie, not, let's just put, like, a Hong Kong movie versus, like, a Hollywood action movie, and where there's, like, stunts involved, where there's fighting involved. You see a fucking Hollywood movie, there's, like, in a fight sequence, there's, like, 70 cuts. Like, you hit and there's a cut. There's a fucking another cut and there's cut again.
So I'll argue to that. It's like, you know, yes, but amazing work from the actor doing this, because it's a lot of, like, if you look in the back scene, like, what they're doing,
yeah,
it's amazing. Respect for that. Absolutely.
For Hollywood or Hong Kong?
Yeah, whatever the actor, like Hollywood, yes, whatever the actor or the actress is doing this, it's like, you know, it's like amazing work. It's like, you know, you can criticize as much as it gets, but when they're doing this scene, even if they're on a cable, etc., it's a lot of physical work. I agree 100%. And I forgot my train of thought. But
compared to the Hong Kong movies, you think you're saying this? They are. I just want to question.
Yes.
Thought.
So, yes, it's like, I would not be afraid to put my life in the line to do an amazing scene. Just for the art of cinema.
Okay.
I would not be afraid to do that. If I was an actor, stuntman, etc. It's exciting.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay to die for my art.
Mm-hmm.
But these days, it's like, well, you cannot do that. Because insurance and this and that and that.
Then go find another job. Go fucking be an accountant. Don't look up. No. What I'm saying is, like, as an audience, as an audience, when you see a Hollywood movie and there's, like, you know, a million different cuts, as opposed to what I was coming to was Jackie Chan. You mentioned a great example. Jackie Chan, do you know how many takes Jackie Chan goes?
I know. It's crazy.
It's, like, crazy. Like, the takes he takes, like, hundreds of takes just to make the scene right.
And you're watching a scene an artistic scene. It's like almost like Cirque du Soleil.
Right.
It's circus. And like, the guy might die when he do that scene, etc.
Right.
And it's amazing. It's amazing. And but this is the thing, is like when Hollywood is trying to bring that to the audience and they put it in a package, etc. Mm. It's like, no, these guys, you know, they might die on the movie set and boom, there it is. They might die on the movie set doing this.
Yeah. And that's what makes like that exciting. Like, you know, an action sequence exciting. It's like talking about William Friedkin, I think he directed French Connection too, right?
Yes.
And do you remember the car chase?
Yes.
Oh.
So I was reading an article on French Connection. When he did the car chase, I think they bribe local police so they could do it.
Mm-hmm.
Someone could have died during that scene.
Oh, fuck, really?
Someone could have died during that scene because it was like, it was not supervised or anything. And I think they bribed the police, etc. And there was an article like, so when he did that scene, which is one of the most amazing car chase scenes in cinema.
Oh, great fucking scene.
In cinema. But this brings back a question. The question that you had is like, I love that challenge. It's like, it's interesting. I love that survival aspect of it. It's like, that's something that's amazing. And we don't have that these days.
No.
We're so protected.
We,
you cannot do this, you cannot do that. And something happens, it's going to be a lawsuit, it's going to be something, etc. It's like, I love that raw art form. And people can argue with it. People can agree with it. But it's a decision. Like, if I'm casting on a Tarantino movie, right? And I'm going to see that I might die. That's my choice. That is my choice.
No,
that is my choice.
Absolutely. And when you say like today, you know, it doesn't exist. It does, but it's very limited. For example, the movie, when I saw the movie and I cinematically, I was really into the movie, was Paul Thomas Anderson's There Will Be Blood. There Will Be Blood, there's a scene in There Will Be Blood where his oil rig explodes. And he carries the kid back to a tool shed, and it's just one shot. And in I watched this recently, I think 2 years back, and when I saw that shot, you see what cinema does, because it's not just direction, it's just acting, it's just the location, it's a camera, and in the music in that scene, it's just. If you look at that scene, it's the music in that scene is very layered. It just builds tension. It's like they add like the first, it's like the drums, and then they put the violin, and then they put like I don't know, kind of like.
Tell me where it hurts. Did you see this?
No.
Tell me where it hurts. Where does it hurt you? Where does it hurt you?
I can't hear my voice.
Were you hit in the head? Were you hit in the head? Tell me. You have to tell me if you were.
I can't hear my voice.
I don't know. Kind of like a gimbal or something. Into the movie, and the tension that creates, it's just fucking raw and gritty. And I think Paul Thomas Anderson does that very well in There Will Be Blood. I don't know if you've seen that movie, but
no, I haven't. And I know you told me about it, but so that scene, were there special effects during that scene?
No fucking special effects.
So this reminds me the Christopher Nolan second Batman with Tom Hardy with Bane. the opening scene. That is my dream. When he goes in the plane and lands, you have the music and you see the plane and he lands on it and they arrive, hijack it, cut the plane in half, and this is like, there's a, you know, there's not enough CGI. Like,
yeah, no.
And even if you and I have a level of passion and education in movies, even the average person will know it's not digital.
Yeah.
Because when you go see Transformers, things like that, like, oh, I'm going to see movies, it's all 3G graphics, whatever, exercise, right, real. The actors interacting. Any crowd, even not super educated with movies, etc., have this conscience of like, oh, it's CGI.
Yeah.
But when you go in a movie where it's not CGI, suddenly you're like, oh my gosh, this is, you know,
it's real. This and is you real. See the effort behind this
is,
it.
You see the effort behind it.
Yeah.
And that scene, that is my favorite opening scene. Like if I had the money, I would say, hey, Christopher, can I jump off the plane? Like when he's like, whew,
and the plane. No, it's just.
It was like, it is amazing.
Even to perceive that scene, like how he orchestrated that scene, it's just. Like, I know it's an idea. If you, to have even the idea of doing that in the beginning of a fucking movie.
That is one of the best opening scenes. Where it's like, for me, it's like you have the plane and suddenly it's like. Yeah, when that scene was like, you see the plane and suddenly it's
and
like.
And there's a bigger fucking.
And the sound goes boom. Christopher Nolan.
Right, right. Hans Zimmer.
It goes on top of it and they're like sucking the stuff. The guys just arrived jumping on the rope and etc. It's like, that scene is like so intense. It's so good. And it's so. Most of it is not CGI.
No, it's not.
And what I said is like, you can take anyone. Anyone knows when it's not CGI.
No, absolutely. It feels real. It feels like Nolan normally don't use CGI for most of his movies. Like in Inception.
And that's why he's good. That's why he's good.
But being good takes effort. I mean, yes. You know, it takes a lot of fucking effort. Even with the scene in Inception where, you know, it rotates, right? Like in the dream sequence, it's an actual set. He just constructed a set for it. Yeah. He could have easily said, oh, let's just do CGI.
But if it was CGI, you would know.
Yeah, no, you would
know. And you would be like, oh, it's CGI. But the fact that you know it's not... That the actors, you pay more attention. You're like, oh, this is not CGI. They were doing this amazing thing, etc. Like subconsciously, you would like think about this, and someone like me would be like, oh my gosh, that scene is like, I would have like split my brain. I'm like, the scene is amazing, but also it's like, oh my gosh, the direction is amazing. They were doing all this shit. It's amazing.
No, no, CGI takes, and I'm not a fan of action movies or not because it's an action movie. I would not go to a movie to watch. Oh, it's an action movie. I mean, I used to when I was a kid, but it has to have something more than that. It has to have, that's what cinema does to me. It has to have the humanity. Like, I need to connect with it. It's just,
this goes back to your original question, which is American cinema for me was gateway of trying thing, adventure, yeah, innovation, not being afraid, not questioning. The French... In the terms of the culture, we always question things. Always. Yes, but if you do this, yes, but if you do that. And I'm like, let's do it. I don't care. We don't know what's going to happen.
Right.
And America is always like that, which is why we have all these, you know. No, French cinema is amazing. There's right. Certain aspect of French cinema I can tell you, and I will tell you in a second.
Right, right.
But American cinema was like, you know, and I was raised like that. I was watching TV shows and I was like dreaming about these things. You know, it's like it was an attraction for me because I love adventure. As a kid, I was raised in the 80s. Right. You know, like going my bicycle for the next 8 hours. My parents didn't know where I were. So it was an attraction for me too. Definitely. Absolutely.
And also American cinema has this attitude of like, I don't give a fuck. And I mean, I'm Indian and I've seen a lot of Indian movies and a lot of Indian movies, they tend to, at least the mainstream movies, now it's changing, which is kind of great, but they tend to cater towards what was familiar before because it's feasible to make a profit. you can make a profit, you know, which is, you know, you have a formula for making a movie, you know. It's just, you know, if it's a love story, just like you put four songs. But then what I like about American movies is that they change it. They're the avant-garde of like changing the shit. It's just with all these directors we talked about, like Coen Brothers or with Blood Simple, right? Great fucking movie. And it kind of evokes something you never felt before, like when you see Coen Brothers Blood Simple, and then the sequence where in the middle of the street, in the middle of the night, I think there's a dead body, or they kill someone, I think, and it's silence. There's no background music.
The soundtrack on Blood Simple is amazing.
Yeah, it's exactly.
It's very intense.
And even Coen Brothers does this, like they do this all the time. They even in No Country for Old Men, the coin toss scene. There's no soundtrack, but then the tension in that scene is like.
And it's funny you said that. So you said two things that's interesting. Is like, and I go back to this, like, American cinema is like America in general. Innovation, startup, Google, Apple, Facebook, Twitter.
Yeah, that, Ford.
Whatever. It's like they're not afraid to innovate, to try. Just let's try. Let's do something. American cinema is the way. It's the same way. And going back to what you said in terms of the Coen Brothers is like, what I love in the Coen Brothers is like there's no soundtrack.
Yep.
Country for Old Men, there's no soundtrack. It's just like, it's like, you know, like everyday life. Is there a soundtrack unless you put your music, whatever? There's none. And it's so intense. It is so intense.
If there were a soundtrack, that would make it less intense.
Yeah, no.
I'm
an anti-soundtrack except when it's John Carpenter.
Yeah, no, he composes his own soundtrack. John Carpenter, yeah.
But it's always minimal. It's always like a beat. No. It's like a heartbeat. He doesn't know it. But I always like, you know, like, and I'm sorry, it was like, you know, like when John Williams in some of Spielberg movies, like, ta-ta, ta-ta, it's like, you know, like...
Star Wars?
Every movie. It's
did
like,
he do Star Wars? I don't know.
Star Wars, but also Harrison Ford in...
Indiana Jones.
Indiana Jones. It's part of the package. Okay, it's part of the package. The music is amazing. Music's good, you know, fine. But it's kind of like, it's part of the package.
Yeah.
But sometimes the no sound intensity is just does everything. It does everything. Watch Country for No Man, No Country for
Old
Country
Man.
There's no music in it.
But it's scary. No Country for Old Men is scary with no fucking music.
There's no music into it.
And it's just the tension. And the lack of it creates a tension that it's like, whoa. And it's just, even the Western movies, you have to talk about Sergio Leone, if you're talking about new music, Once Upon a Time in...
It's interesting you say that, because it's the opposite.
With the Sergio Leone?
Yeah.
Like, the good, the bad, the ugly, there is no music in the first 30 minutes.
But the music...
It's iconic, though.
Is so good.
Do you remember that... No, there's this noise that in the Ennio Morricone do.
Yes. And even in Once Upon a Time in America, the music is, but he knows where it needs to be.
Yeah. So Ennio Morricone, you said music, how the lack of it creates tension. In Ennio Morricone, with the Sergio Leone, he created tension. And if you see Once Upon a Time in the West, Once Upon a Time in
an amazing movie.
In America. Yes. If you haven't seen that movie, if whoever's listening, please go watch it. But great fucking movie. And sometimes it's not just the music, sometimes even the wind blowing. Like the first scene in Once Upon a Time in America, it's like in the rain, it's in the train tracks and the wind is blowing and it's just like, and he's waiting and it's, And I don't, and people complain that, you know, the movies are 3 hours long. I don't care if Once Upon a Time in America is like 5 hours long. I'll still watch it.
So this is what I'm going to tell you. And I can challenge anyone in Hollywood.
Yes.
On it. And it's not a challenge. It's, you have movies.
Yeah.
Like the Coen Brother movie that we talked about.
Blood Simple?
No, not the other one. The one that has no music.
No Country for Old Men.
So No Country for Old Men. Yeah. So we have a movie like No Country for Old Men. No music. It's intense.
Yeah.
It's intense. And we can relate to that because every day when we do things, whatever the situation, there'd be no music in the background. It's
like, yeah, super intense. Yes, yeah, yeah.
And then you have the other hand, John Williams, making the score of Indiana Jones, ta ta ta, and every scene, like he takes a glass, pa 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 pa. It's like it's all intense.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
Fine. Yeah. And then you have Sergio Leone, who makes this amazing soundtrack. But when you watch Sergio Leone, Ennio Morricone, sorry. So you watch Ennio Morricone making soundtrack for Sergio Leone when he makes Once Upon a Time in America, etc. The soundtrack is with the visual, with the sound effects,
mm-hmm.
and he's in between back and forth, and he's telling a story. So when you say the wind, so suddenly it's like, you know, there's a scene and there's wind, and then you have Sergio Leone with the marimba, who's like,
oh.
He does it in a way where he goes like back and forth with the story.
Yeah, it's one with the scene.
Yes,
yeah.
And it and the music is not like to say, oh, we're gonna make it super intense, you know.
No.
We're gonna make it super intense, like, you know, the horror movie, like we're gonna intensify. No, he's part of the storytelling. So he knows, so Ennio Morricone knows how to be present.
Mm-hmm.
Big screen, ta-ta, he has the music, you know, the horror stuff. But he knows how to shut up too. He knows how to shut up.
That's the key. You know when you know when to shut up. You know when to shut up.
He knows how to shut up.
And then that's the thing which I hate about, like, that's the beauty of it. And that's where, like, movies sometimes they spoon feed you. When you're doing something dramatic, there's dramatic music playing. And in the subtitles, it says dramatic music playing right now.
Look, so movies is like food.
Yeah, there could be junk. Yeah.
So movies like food. You bring a plate and you put a lot of cream and salt. Who doesn't like butter, cream, and salt? We all love butter, cream, and salt. Just put the butter and cream and salt. And at the end of you're like, oh my gosh, this was amazing, etc.
Yeah.
But you go back home and I'm like, that was not amazing. That was not amazing. So it's a cheap trick.
Yeah, it's like Taco Bell.
It's a cheap trick. Yes, you're not satisfied. At the moment you are. But it's not a movie you're going to remember. You're not going to say, oh, I'm going to watch this movie again and again and again. It's a cheap trick, which is a lot about, you know, when you watch the Netflix movies.
Yeah, it's again like...
It's like, I was... and then you don't know what you have watched.
I mean, that's what we deal with right now in 2022. Is like there's a lot of quantity about... There's like a lot of content. There's a lot of quantity of movies. But then the quality aspect of it. How many movies that you can remember...
No.
In like 5 years.
There
How
go.
Many movies can
I
you
don't
remember?
Remember?
Exactly. It's really forgettable because it's not real. Like, is there a movie like Once Upon a Time in... Or whichever movie we talked about right now, like Miller's Crossing or No Country for Old Men. These are the movies we remember because there's just a vivid... It's like again, going back to what we said, it's something which we never saw before. It's like, wow. It's like this is an experience, you know, and that's that. I think that's what's beautiful about cinema, you know, and so, you know, John Williams, it's kind of like synonymous to Disney movies and Marvel movies today, and you know, Spider-Man, Avengers. It's like, you know, when you're doing something, there's like background music to support that.
And I mean, he does a good job. He does a good job.
Yeah, he does a good job.
And like when you would see Star Wars, like my kids brought me to see John Williams concert at the Hollywood Bowl, and he had like Jaws, and you know, and he did a good job.
No, he does a good
he
job.
He does a good job. He was like very cinematic, etc. Like, is it to the level of what I like? Maybe not, but he did a good job. Respect. Absolutely. Respect.
No, it's not that we don't like them. I mean, I like some Marvel movies. I like Guardians of the Galaxy, which is a great fucking movie. I like it.
But you're aware. You're self-aware. Like,
I'm self-aware why I'm watching this movie.
Yes, exactly.
But Guardians of the Galaxy is a great fucking movie in the space that it's in. You know, I'm not comparing this with...
And that's because you're a fan of cinema. And you take, like, when I watch a movie, I'm two person. There's Guillaume watching the movie to enjoy the movie. And
right.
There's Winnow's, like, the editing, the light, the background, and everything. Like, I split myself.
Absolutely.
Into to watch that.
Yeah, and you know what you're getting into. Like, in life, that's what you do, right? You know what you're getting into. You know you're signing up for a Marvel movie. And you have this expectation, I'm going to watch a Marvel movie. And if it turns out to be great, it's great. It's not bad that you enjoy a Marvel movie or a, you know, John Williams background score. You
and
know?
It's like, I'm super critical.
Yeah.
I'm super critical.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
But on the other hand, I'm respectful for the work that's behind it. Because it's easy. It's easy to critic. There are people who do things and people who critic. So sometimes I critique movies and I'm being super critical, but I also respect the work behind it, what people try to do. Respect it. It's just very, very respectful. Very respectful. But going back to your original question, you remind me of something I said to a friend. And that's, I think that's the bulk of our conversation, and which is why American cinema has inspired me. So you have this American guy and this French guy. Lying down in his lawn chair in the hill, watching the sky, summer, it's beautiful. You know, it's like you have the Milky Way, beautiful. And they're drinking a beer together and they're like super good buddies, etc. And they look at the sky. And then after that, they look at each other.
Mm.
And then the American guy stands up. Mm. He goes and stands up and says, let's go. And the French guy says, yes, but that's exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is.
There's a reason, there's an excuse. Like, yeah. Yeah, no, I totally get it.
And that's me. That's me. That's, you know, if you ask me like a very profound question, like why? I don't know. I don't have all the answers.
Mm.
But it's like just going, do it. Take the risk. It might not work. It might fail. I might die, but something's going to happen.
Right.
That excites me. That drives me.
And that's great. And I think that's why, like, you were into, you know, you came to, you know, you were into American movies and all those movies you watched all throughout these years. And you are really perceptive about movies, which I appreciate and enjoy having conversations with.
And it's the background, the story behind it, like understanding, like why they make these movies, what was behind it.
Yeah.
You know, what happened? You know, they're trying to raise money to do these movies and it was crazy. It's like entrepreneurship. It's entrepreneurship.
Right. It's entrepreneurship. It's just like being a director. It's mean like
you might lose everything. It's like when we watch that Netflix, the movies that made us, Freddy Krueger. Nightmare on Elm Street.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy, and they go to the special effects guy, says, you have $15,000 budget. He was broke.
Yeah.
He was completely broke. He's like, well, I had no job. And he came to me and said, like, you have $15,000 to make special effects. He said, oh, okay, I'll take it. He had no clue how to do this. And when you see the result of the movie, it is amazing. He came up with like these amazing creative ideas, like you know, even today, watch it, like the blood scene with the, you know, the bed that's reversed, etc. It's amazing.
Right.
The guy made it happen. One of the most amazing horror movies. Amazing.
No, yeah, it's, you know, when the budget is like really slim and you need to make it happen, you know, that's where you become creative. And and with Jaws is a great example. They never use a shark, and it was always like a fin, and they used it in the ocean, And John Williams, back to John Williams, it's just the BG, the background music. But it's like, it's just very monotonous. It's like,
and everybody remembers it.
So it's like. So it's like, it's just, again, it's great because it's building tension again, right? So, no, okay, so we were talking about Ennio Morricone and its collaboration with Sergio Leone. And it's funny that, you know, Sergio Leone, being Italian, making spaghetti. I mean, did he make any spaghetti western? Like, he made the good, the bad, the ugly, didn't he? It was a spaghetti western.
Yeah, it's that period of time that's referred in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Right.
With the spaghetti western culture, right. and things like that. Yes, so he did. Yes,
he did. Being Italian, he came in. He and people still in film schools in America, they read about and study about Sergio Leone movies. You know, coming from Italy. So going back to my previous point, from France, right? You being French, where do you think, I mean, you know, the how the French cinema is, or where do you think the French cinema is going? Because
it's, I mean, I've lost connection with the French cinema to some certain level, so I was inspired with some original French cinema, Henri Verneuil, John Woo was inspired by Henri Verneuil, so like all the, it's a certain level of culture in French cinema. And but there's certain aspect of it that is amazing, that is unique. Like one of my favorite movie from French cinema is Michel Deville, who directed Une Nuit d'été en ville. That's the name of it in French, which is Summer Night in Town. And that movie is an hour and a half with a girl, mm-hmm. who invites a guy to her house. And they're flirting with each other for an hour and a half. And the camera moves from the living room, the bath, they're taking a bath together, the bedroom, etc.
Interesting.
There's no sex.
That sucks.
No. That's Why? The beauty of it. Because it would be so obvious. You know, they love each other. They're super into each other. But they're like charming each other for an hour and a half.
But they don't have sex.
No, they don't.
Why?
Because they don't have to. And that's the beauty of it.
Who it's says like, that?
Huh?
Who says that?
I say that. Who says that? I said that. And just the build up of them being together and attracted to each other. It's an hour and a half. Them charming, laughing, challenging themselves. And an hour and a half. How do you keep an audience an hour and a half in an apartment, right? From the living room to the bathroom, some level of the bedroom, etc. There's no sex. There's no sex. But you know they're super attracted to each other. And you're watching this scene. That is amazing. That is one of the most amazing movies I've seen from French cinema. Like, very impressed about it in terms of the way they've done it. In the way they directed it, because you watch the entire thing and it's like, and there's no sex.
That's beautiful. I mean, they could have had sex, but then they deprive the sex aspect and they want to like extend the tension.
Yes.
And do you think this is like an aspect of French cinema where they like, they put this love on a pedestal and
yes.
Sex is going to ruin.
Sex is going to be...
Because that's like, the culmination of romance.
It's going to be this romance. Easy sell trick.
Yeah.
Of like, oh, we're going to want to see them have sex together. And it's an easy sell trick. And he didn't go to that easy sell trick. He's like, no, I'm going to show you these two people loving each other and discovering each other, you know, etc. But we're not going to go to sex because you used to have that in that format in a movie. Like, oh, they're going to have sex. And they don't. And the last scene is they're together until like 7 a.m., whatever, etc.
Uh-huh.
And they go to sleep together, like they lie down and they sleep against each other and they fall asleep. And that's amazing because the director did an amazing job. You watch the entire movie.
Yeah.
And you're expecting that they're going to have sex. You're going to have that, you know, you're going to have the cell scene, you know, and they don't. They don't. And it's amazing. It's beautiful.
No, that's beautiful. It's just, I mean, again, like, you know.
And that's one thing is like, you could not do that in American cinema.
No, it's just like you get straight to sex. And that's part like, of the and package. Then you get to know about each other.
It's part of the package. And that's wonderful. That's amazing. That's unique.
No, that's amazing. And no, it's maybe it's cultural or maybe, you know, it's directorial or maybe it's just that cinema. But, you know, and it's interesting how it gets differentiated between countries that, you know, in France that. There are movies like this, and I don't know, like, there are movies like that in America, too, but not that often. Like, there's, like, you know, I don't know, like, the three movies directed by Richard Linklater, but Before Midnight, Before Sunrise, and all that, but no, that's beautiful, and being a Parisian, is that a term Parisian is a term. From being Paris and then coming to America and then, you know, being interested in all these action, gory, I'm assuming, correct me if I'm wrong, action, gory movies and really explore. I think it's a quality of being an artist and it's great, you know, and that's why we talked about, we connected on this passion because I'm Indian and, you know, and I lived in India, watched a lot of Indian movies, but then you being from France and from Paris, and we connected on the same level because of movies, because of our interest in movies. Because why is that? Is what I think. Why is that? And I kind of want to wrap this up, by answering this. Why I think that is because movies and cinema has this humanity. At the core, it's the humanity. You know, irrespective of the language they speak, it's you're trying to communicate the basic human emotions, and it's as complex as it is when you see it on the big screen. It's very it's mutual and it's very connecting between.
Yeah, I think that's the most important. It's like it engages in the discussion. Where, like, why did you like these movies? And for me, it was like, not even like, why you like Coen Brothers? It's like, why do you like this specific movie from Coen Brothers? That was my question to you. It's like, oh, not like, oh my gosh, V, you're like, you know, Indian guy. Why do you like these Coen Brothers movies? Like, hold on, I don't care. It's like, but why this specific movie from Coen Brothers? And we had a discussion about that. And you're right. And then it creates this, like, discussion that is amazing, which is, you know, very empowering, which is amazing. Like you create this connection with people.
No, absolutely. And we got to know because of, you know, we both worked at the same company, and then, you know, when we talked about the movies we like, and we found this mutual connection about the movies we like, and that made, and not just even Chadwick is behind the scene, and the camera is not on him. I like to be on him, but he's not in here. But like a lot of people, it's like doesn't matter because, you know, you're from Paris and Chadwick, who's from Georgia, and I'm from India, and what connects all of them? And I don't think it's cinema. It's beneath cinema. What cinema underlies, it's like basic humanity, and that's what connects people. And I think it's beautiful, and cinema as a medium, it's that powerful to do that. And and on that note, that unless you have anything, any closing arguments, I like to toast. Thank you. Thank you for coming, and being the first guest on this podcast. And I'm glad that you liked the whiskey.
Yeah, it's very smooth.
It is very smooth and really sweet, just like you are. Yes. Just like I've known you the past couple of years, and thank you. I'm really honored that I've got to share this podcast on the subject I love about cinema, and that's pretty much it. And unless you want to share something,
I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Great.
Okay. Thank you.
Otherwise, I'd be expanding.
That was so awkward.
I'd be expanding for fucking hours.
Mm.